Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. How are you? Anybody fabulous? Like, we've got a couple. We don't lie in church. We don't do that. So happy to have you here in worship this morning. I always want to direct your attention to our announcements that we have printed for you in the bulletin if you've been watching the announcement loop on the screen as well, just so that you're aware of some of those upcoming events. With this being a new month, it's December, friends. We've got some of those regularly happening things, first week of the month, like fellowship coffee, things like that. If you are interested in attending those things, pick up a calendar out at the Welcome Center, or dare I say it, take your bulletin home and put it somewhere, like on your fridge or somewhere where you will remember that we've got these things upcoming. So also, if you want to contribute to our Christmas cookie gifting for those who are shut in, those that we will be providing some holiday cheer to, if you would talk to Robin or Sandra or Maribeth about contributing a few dozen cookies and helping maybe with the packaging and delivery of those, that would be great. That will be coming up as well. That is printed for you in your book. Friends, this is the first Sunday of the Advent season. Reading to you from the book of Isaiah, chapter 7, verse 14. All right then, the Lord himself will give you the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. We are pausing today to remember that we have hope. I couldn't ask for better background music than that. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we invite your spirit into this beautiful Advent season. Renew our sense of holy anticipation. Let us be those who are waiting eagerly for Jesus to come again. And more than anything, we ask, Lord, that you would be glorified in this season of expectation. In your name we pray. Amen. Are you ready to praise this morning?
Yes.
We've got some excellent song leadership. Would you all stand and let's join together in singing this morning?
Thank you.
And as we come to a time of prayer, I will ask you again to pay attention to your bulletin as we share those prayer concerns each and every week, those special prayer requests. We also have a section in our bulletin where it says, who and what else can I pray for this week? And those suggestions there are just, you're going to find some of our church family, you're going to find some of the things that are happening in our community, ideas for you to pray for. When you see those names listed there, friends, that's not because there's a specific need. It's because we just pray for our church family. In the special prayer request, we do continue prayers for Joanne. Tom Ahrens had a successful surgery. Which he said, other than a needle, he would have never known anything happened. So, and I don't know, Tom, if we tell everybody that your brain is okay now, or, but surgery to treat a brain aneurysm, and home the next day, and feeling great, and we just rejoice and we give thanks for that. Friends, I also want you to keep in mind, we've got those in our church family, maybe in your own family, that this season isn't maybe bright and shiny, maybe not happy, maybe they're mourning a loss, maybe they've got someone who's missing from the activities this year, and we keep those folks in mind as well. It's not going to be easy for some that are in a time of distress or turmoil, so we want to make sure and pay special attention to those folks who need a little extra support, a little extra prayer. Again, we've got them in our church family. You've probably got them in your family and in our community. So we're going to extend that blanket of prayer to those who need that extra help this season. For those of us who are eagerly anticipating shopping, baking, meal planning, traffic jams, self-checkouts, anybody eagerly anticipating any of those things? Anybody trying to be in denial of those things? I want us to really take time to put aside the busyness of the season that we might recognize. We don't have Christmas without Christ. And that is what we celebrate, and that is what we pray for, and that is what we are going to focus on here at Faith Community Church in this season. So let's take a moment. Be in silent prayer, and then I will pray for us. Let's take a moment to be in prayer. Good morning, God. We thank you for bringing us together in a time of worship this morning. And I pray, Lord, that you would open your word to us in new ways, in exciting ways that offer us hope and renewal and refreshment. We do, first and foremost, always come to you with thankful hearts, Lord. Grateful to be part of your family, grateful for a season where we are looking forward to celebrating the birth of Christ, also his second coming. Grateful for the many, many blessings you have bestowed upon us, our family, our friends, our times of celebration, the excitement we see with children during this time. We give you thanks and we acknowledge your work in our world around us. I do lift up to you this morning, Lord, those who are not with us in worship, whether they are ill or shut in, traveling, men and women serving our country, perhaps those who have a work obligation in a helping profession, Lord, where they aren't able to be in this regular hour of worship. Would you let them know in this moment they are being prayed for, that we think of them, that we care for them, that we lift them up to you. We do especially, Lord, ask that in a time when our churches get busy, you offer us those moments of pause, those moments of reflection, that time to really think about what this story means to us, what this journey looks like to us in this Advent season. We thank you. We boldly come before you and lay our burdens at your feet. And I ask, Lord, that you would set us free to worship this morning. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Friends, I will ask all of you to take a moment to pass the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Won't you take a moment to greet one another this morning? How many of you are willing to admit it? How many of you are Thanksgiving Day put up the Christmas tree kind of folks? How many of you are day after Thanksgiving? Weekend after? How many of you haven't done it yet? Have you noticed though, even as we drive through town, what a difference a week makes. It was Thanksgiving, and now everything is Christmas. Our streets are lined with the Christmas decorations. It's been in the stores for a while, but now even more so. You walk into the stores, and everything is Christmas, and I've even seen a few folks wearing their Christmas sweaters already. So the season has changed. And, you know, we tend to pull out all of our decorations from their storage places, and few folks have said, well, I had to get my outdoor lights up while the weather was nice, right? So there are already lights going up outside and being lit at night, and some of us unpack the Christmas tree and try to assemble it again, and we're paying special attention to make sure all those branches are in just the right place, and going through our, how many of you do themed Christmas trees? Like this year it's red, and next year it's M&Ms, and the year after that it's the Packers. Okay, fine. I'm going to try however I can. How many of you have trees loaded with decorations that your kids either made or received, or you made or received? How many of you let kids decorate your tree so that it's like waist high? Yeah, some kids have their own. But it's part of the joy of decorating for Christmas, I think, finding the perfect tree. Artificial trees or real trees? Anybody doing a real tree? Yeah? How many of you have done a real tree in the past? Have that memory of driving to maybe even a Christmas tree farm and walking out and picking out the right tree and cutting it down and Not the illegal through your backyard neighbor thing, but like a place that was actually designed for that. And you know, it seems like whether you're looking for that real tree or the artificial tree, if you're shopping, if you're out and about looking for a new tree, you're really focused on finding just the right one. Maybe for your space that you're putting it in or how it looks. You know, most of us don't go out to the Christmas tree farm and say, well, I want the one that looks like it's dying and all the needles on the ground. You don't want that one. Maybe some of you, though, remember Charlie Brown Christmas. His quest for the Christmas tree and a Charlie Brown Christmas. Lucy tells Chuck and Linus, you know, she charges them with going to find the perfect Christmas tree for the children's Christmas pageant. And she wants a tree that reflects the modern Christmas spirit. And as the two boys enter the Christmas tree lot, I don't remember if you remember this from the movie or not, but there's just an array of trees there, and they're all different colors. They were pink and purple and orange, and as a kid, I didn't think too much of it. As an adult, I'm like, why are they different colors? But it was part of the movie, and Linus actually walks up to one of the trees and knocks on it, and it sounds like metal. And then the boys spy the tree that they want. It's kind of in the middle of everything. It's little, barely a branch. And Linus comments, he says, I didn't know they still made wooden ones, right? I didn't know they still made wooden Christmas trees. And it isn't much, but it's the perfect tree to Charlie Brown and Linus. So they carry it back to the school where their friends are rehearsing for the pageant, only the Peanuts gang, right? All their friends there, they're not so enthusiastic. They're pretty quick to make fun of this pathetic looking little tree, and not just make fun of the tree, but kind of give Charlie Brown a hard time too for making such a poor choice. And I remember quite well then, you know, shoulders sagging and feet dragging. He takes his tree and he heads for home. And when we watch that as a kid, we think, oh no, it's sad, it's not fair. And then I'm thinking, well, are we really terribly surprised by the reaction of Charlie Brown's friends? I mean, it really wasn't, it was a pretty pathetic little tree. Not the one that you and I would pick out, I'm sure. Definitely not what most people would have chosen. It wasn't spectacular in any way. It was plain. It was meager. And you're saying, great, why are you retelling us the story of a Charlie Brown Christmas? What does this have to do with anything? I'm glad you asked. Charlie Brown's choice of a Christmas tree is actually very similar to a plain, unlikely choice that God made. A choice that God made in who would be the mother to bear the Messiah. And that woman, Mary, is going to be the focus of our attention today as we begin our journey to Bethlehem, our journey to Christmas, our journey to a deeper, more meaningful relationship with this Messiah whose birth we celebrate each and every year. So it doesn't take much to realize that Mary was a lot like that little Christmas tree that Charlie Brown picked out for the Christmas pageant. There is nothing special about her. She's very plain. She's not rich. She didn't have any prestigious social standing. She lived in a very modest home, what you and I would define as a cave. There would have been nothing about her to make her stand out in any way from the hundreds of other women of her day who went about their regular chores of fetching water and cooking and cleaning and otherwise looking after the well-being of their families. And she's from Nazareth. And you're going to say, what difference does that make? And I'll say, I'm glad you asked. Nazareth, at the time of Jesus' birth, nothing more than a very tiny, insignificant village, what we would call podunk. Right? And there's a reason that when Philip shared with his friend Nathaniel that he had found the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth, Nathaniel's response was, you know, you got to be kidding me, because Nazareth, can anything good come from there? Can anything good come from Nazareth? But something very, very good did come from there. And of all the places God could have gone, and all the women God could have chosen to bear the Messiah, God sent the angel Gabriel to this tiny village to knock on the door of a plain, humble young woman, Mary. So what does it mean that God went to Nazareth instead of one of the big cities of the day? What does it mean that he chose a plain, simple girl instead of a very refined, cultured woman? I think before Jesus is even born, God is teaching us anew, reminding us of his long-established values, that God favors the meek, the humble, those who do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God, those who love others as they love themselves, those who take up their cross daily to follow him. And God saw in Mary that kind of humble servant, the kind that he desires for all of us to be. And despite all the challenges, Mary did not disappoint. So our scripture this morning is coming from the book of Luke, the first chapter, verses 26 through 38. I'll be using the New Living Translation this morning. I invite you to open your Bibles or your Bible app, or for Friends, it's printed for you in the bulletin this week if you would like to follow along. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, who is Mary's cousin, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month, for the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. That is God's word for us this morning. Thanks be to God. Could you imagine being in Mary's shoes? Guys, too, why not? Can you imagine what that would have been like? What would it be like to be visited by an angel? A messenger from God. What would it be like to be told that you're going to become pregnant and not in the usual way, but because God has chosen you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you and you will conceive and bear none other than the Messiah? And we read that story and we think, well, that was then, and that was Mary, and that was a whole different thing, because, come on, if I were to take that news out into the world today, people would call me crazy, right? I would be admitted to the local mental institution. We have a couple expectant moms in our congregation. Try telling somebody, "Yup, it's God's," right? Immaculate conception. People are going to be like, "I don't think so." But here's the thing, that the scenario really wasn't all that different for Mary. In that time, nobody was going to believe a story like that. And to add to that, in her day, the penalty for pregnancy out of wedlock, it wasn't just, well, people in town are going to talk about you. The penalty for being pregnant out of wedlock was a crime. It was punishable by death. Now, at best, under normal circumstances, Mary would have been abandoned by Joseph because of her supposed infidelity. And assuming she even made it through the dangerous ordeal of childbirth on her own, she would have been ostracized by her family and her community. She would have been left to raise her child as a single mother. She would have been mocked and ridiculed, and she would have been an outcast. That didn't stop her. It didn't stop her. All those challenges didn't keep Mary from doing what she knew in her heart was the right thing to do. It didn't stop her from opening herself for the work of God that was to happen through her. And as a humble servant, Mary took up her cross and followed the most unlikely path described by Gabriel. And in this early part of the gospel, Mary is the star of the show. You know, there's a pastor who tells in a devotional article that he had written. He talks about the annual Christmas pageant at his church. And each year as Advent approaches, the children are all gathered, and the parts of the Christmas pageant are assigned. And the children play all of the parts, Mary and Joseph and the, the wise men and the shepherds and the animals. Everything is played by the kids. And he says, though, there is no part more popular than the part of Mary. Only when the question, who wants to be Mary, is asked, do all of the little hands in the room fly up in the air in eager anticipation. And yet this pastor, in his devotional, he reflects on that and says, you know, I wonder if Mary wanted to be Mary. As a young woman, a girl, really, early teen years, she compromised her entire future. She surrendered her body and she carried within her the Christ child for 9 months. Do you think Mary wanted to be Mary? She became Theotokos in the Greek, the God-bearer. She went through the ordeal of pregnancy and labor and childbirth, and she went on to nurture that child, and she fed him, and she clothed him, and she raised him, and taught him the scriptures and modeled faith for him. And 33 years later, after he had taught the world about this unfathomable love of God, Mary watched him die on a cross in accordance with God's will. The will of God, which she knew requires so much of all of God's servants. Do you think Mary wanted to be Mary? You know, sometimes when God calls us, what he calls us to, just, it isn't easy. It maybe isn't what we dream about. It isn't maybe what we thought was going to happen. It could even be risky. It could seem dangerous. It could separate us from everything that we know and love. And that's where we have so much to learn from Mary. We can't downplay Mary's significance in history. There is no other person besides Jesus himself who plays a greater role in the salvation of the human race than Mary. And it was all because of her faith in the God who called her and her willingness to serve him. So what is it we need to take from this scripture this morning? You've probably heard it before. We read it this time of the year, every year. What do you take from it? What do we need to take from it? What is God trying to say? That God favors the humble and the lowly, and we need to make sure that our hearts and our minds are always in the right place to respond to God's call? Is that what we're supposed to learn? Absolutely. Maybe the thing to remember is that nothing is impossible with God. Right? That's important too. How many of you are willing when Ashley and Callan say, yup, it was God, to say, well, that can happen. Nothing is impossible with God. No pressure, ladies. Does this story remind us that God is the giver of all life, of all new life? Certainly it does. But the most important part of this story is that when Mary was asked to do something that was hard isn't even the right word. She's asked to do something that is beyond tremendously difficult, right? She's asked to surrender everything and serve God. And when she is asked, she says yes. She says yes. Are we so very willing? This Advent season, as we prepare once again for the Christmas celebration, not only remembering Christ's birth, but anticipating the day he will come again, we do need to take time to search our hearts and search our minds. We need to ask the tough questions of ourselves and examine our values. In the midst of the chaos of Christmas shopping and programs and parties, we need to hit the pause button. We need to humble ourselves before God in prayer and say, I am your servant. I am the Lord's servant. God, I am your servant. And then as we listen for that often unexpected call from God, we all need to explore our own willingness so that, like Mary, we can say yes. Yes, God, whatever you have in store for me, I'm yours. Use me to fulfill your purpose. Friends, this Advent season, will you take that time to pause and reflect, to consider your willingness and what it means to say yes? Let's pray. Gracious Father in heaven, thank you for calling us, for putting that call on our hearts, and for helping us to see and to understand what our role is and what our purpose is in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ and doing the work of your kingdom. Lord, would you help us? Help us to be ready, to be open, and to be willing for anything, for everything, for whatever it is that you would have us do, whatever you have planned for us, whatever you have in store for us. And it's not always easy. God, it's not always what we would choose, but we trust you. We trust you. And we humbly come before you as your servants, as your children, part of your flock, the sheep of your pasture, part of your family, asking, Lord, that you would guide us and you would bring light to our path and you would equip us for the road in front of us. The Advent season is upon us, and God, I ask that you would take our worries and our anxieties from us, all that busyness that seems to take over. Would you take all of that and replace it simply with your presence? Open the scriptures to us again, Lord, in new and exciting ways. The story of Mary and Joseph, the birth of Jesus. May our journey to Christmas this year hold with it each and every day the contemplation and the reflection upon that first journey that happened so long ago. And just as those who were waiting so eagerly for the Messiah to come the first time, we will be waiting, Lord, with that same eager anticipation for our Savior to come again. We're so thankful. We're so thankful, God, to have this time to celebrate and to learn and to prepare and to grow and to worship. Thank you for the journey. Thank you for reminding us of how you work, and not just what, but who, Lord, we are looking forward to. Use us this season. Call us to your plan. Call us to your partnership as we share the miracle of Jesus' birth with all of those around us. And it is in your name that we pray. Amen. Friends, if you would open your hymnals to number 259, we're going to stand and sing together, Angels from the Realms of Glory, 259 in your hymnal. And we will do verses 1, 2, and 5. Again, number 259 in your hymnal.
Story.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, as you leave this place today, may our Lord bless you, keep you, make his face to shine upon you, now and forever. Amen. Have a blessed week.